Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, John Russell reports on the return of an ancient Japanese art that was once in danger of dying out. Then Brian Lin presents this week's science report. We close the show by hearing the lesson of the day. But first,
Eiko Araki is an expert of the Sanuki Kagari Temari, a Japanese traditional craft. The craft has been passed down for more than 1,000 years on the island of Shikoku. Araki is at the center of a small circle of women who are working hard to make temari. These balls are small artistic objects that have colorful designs. They can take weeks or months to finish. Some cost hundreds of dollars, although others are less costly. The balls are not for sports. They are created as special objects carrying prayers for health and goodness. They might be treasured like a painting in a Western home. Out of nothing, something this beautiful is born, bringing joy, said Araki about the temari. I want it to be remembered there are beautiful things in this world that can only be made by hand. The area where temari began was good for growing cotton. The round creations continue to be made out of that material. At Araki's studio, which also serves as head office for Temari's Preservation Society, there are 140 colors of cotton thread. The women dye them by hand, using plants, flowers, and other natural ingredients. Outside the studio, cotton thread, in different colors, hangs outside in the shade to dry. The lengthy process starts with making the basic ball. The careful work with thread, called stitching, is done on the ball. The outer covering of rice grains, called husks, are cooked and then dried and placed in a piece of cotton. Then the materials are wound with thread over and over until, almost magically, a ball appears. Then the stitching begins. The balls are surprisingly hard, so each stitch requires a careful, almost painful push. These days, temari is getting new recognition among Japanese and foreigners as well. Caroline Kennedy, for example, took lessons in the ball making when she was United States Ambassador to Japan 10 years ago. Yoshi Nakamura promotes Japanese handcrafted art in her shop at Tokyo's Haneda Airport. Nakamura says she features temari there because of its complex designs. Temari that might have been every day in a faraway era is now being used for interior decoration, she said. I really feel each Sanuki Kagari temari speaks of a special, one and only existence in the world. Araki has come up with some newer designs that feel both modern and historical. She is trying to make the balls more available for everyday life. For example, some of the balls can be used to beautify Christmas trees. Araki often travels to Tokyo to teach, but mostly she works and gives lessons in her studio. She started out as a metalwork artist. Her husband's parents were temari masters who worked hard to bring back the art form when it was at risk of dying out. They were not emotional people. They rarely gave praise, and instead always scolded her, she remembers. It is a tough love teaching method that is common in many Japanese traditional arts, from kabuki acting to hogaku music. These art forms demand a lifetime of selfless devotion. Today, only a small number of people, all women, can make the temari balls to traditional standards. Araki said that the most difficult issue is training the next generation. She added that it usually takes over 10 years to train them, so you need people who are willing to continue the craft for a very long time. But, she explained, when people start to feel joy along with the hardship that comes with making temari, they tend to keep going. I'm John Russell.
The American Space Agency, NASA, has cleared a spacecraft to launch next month to look for possible signs of life on Jupiter's moon Europa. Agency officials announced plans for the Europa Clipper spacecraft at a press briefing last week. The launch window for the mission will open October 10th. The spacecraft is to launch from NASA's Kennedy Space Center in Florida. It will be carried to space aboard a Falcon Heavy rocket built by SpaceX. The main goal of the mission is for the spacecraft to collect data on whether Jupiter's icy moon could possibly support life. Scientists have identified Europa as a good candidate for holding the right conditions to support life. Several studies have suggested it likely contains a very large ocean beneath its icy surface. In an online description, NASA says liquid water is necessary for planets or moons to support the complex chemistry processes that can make life possible. A huge, salty ocean likely lies beneath Europa's surface and could hold more water than Earth's oceans combined, the space agency added. Scientists have also discovered evidence of chemical compounds and energy forces, including very strong gravity, that could provide the right conditions to support life. Europa is a little smaller than Earth's moon, but is still one of the largest moons in our solar system. It is one of many moons orbiting Jupiter. Astronomers announced in 2023 they had discovered 12 additional moons orbiting Jupiter. NASA says the planet now has a total of 95 confirmed moons. It is estimated to take 6 years for the robotic, solar-powered spacecraft to reach Europa. The orbiter is the largest spacecraft built by NASA to investigate another planet. It reaches about 30 meters when fully open. The orbiter is expected to perform many flybys of Europa. Some may get as close as 25 kilometers away from the moon. After launching, NASA says Europa Clipper will fly past Mars, then back toward Earth, using the gravity of each planet to increase its momentum. These kinds of gravity assists are expected to provide the needed push to get the spacecraft to Jupiter by 2030. After reaching Jupiter, Europa Clipper will then spend about 1 year preparing for the flybys of Europa. NASA says the spacecraft is equipped with 9 different scientific instruments. They are designed to collect data from all areas of the Moon. None of the instruments themselves were built with the ability to confirm the existence of life forms. But they are designed to investigate Europa's icy surface and the composition of the Moon's underground ocean for signs of possible life. Team leaders say Europa Clipper will also use several cameras, including 2 using infrared technology, to map the Moon in greater detail than in the past. Radar technology will also be used to collect data on the Moon's interior and to measure gravity. Together, the instruments and cameras will seek information about Europa's current and past chemistry and geology. Gina DeBrasio is the acting director of NASA's Planetary Science Division in Washington. She told the press briefing the agency is pleased to finally be moving the mission forward after years of planning and preparation. As an ocean world, Europa is very intriguing, and this mission is going to help us to understand a complex piece of our solar system. Jordan Evans is Europa Clipper's project manager. He said the last part of the preparation process involved testing of electronic transistors widely used on the spacecraft. His team wanted to make sure the transistors could survive the large amounts of radiation Europa Clipper is expected to be hit with in space. After the tests, Evans said mission leaders were persuaded that the transistors could recover from the effects of heavy radiation during breaks from flybys of the Moon. He said this meant all elements of the mission should be able to be carried out as planned. Evans added, "We are ready for Jupiter." I'm Brian Lynn.
Now, Brian Lynn is here to talk more about his science report. Thanks for joining me, Brian.
Of course, Ashley. Glad to be back.
This week, you reported on an upcoming NASA mission that will explore Jupiter's moon, Europa. How does this mission differ from other recent explorations involving NASA?
Yes, NASA has been very clear about the fact that the Europa Clipper mission has a very specific goal, and that is to collect data on whether Europa has the right conditions to support possible life forms. Of course, not every space mission has this goal, the search for life. But in this case, it certainly is, since this moon in Jupiter's orbit has already been identified as an ideal candidate to possibly support life. The main reason for that is because Europa is thought to have a huge underground ocean, and scientists believe liquid water is very necessary to support the complex chemical processes that can make life possible.
And How will the data collection efforts on this mission differ from what is currently taking place on Mars, for example?
So there are definitely similarities between these. The mission goals on Mars are also heavily centered on gathering evidence on possible signs of life. But the real difference is that on Mars, NASA has two rovers operating on the Martian surface. So the data these explorers gather is captured on the planet itself. Europa Clipper, on the other hand, is an orbiter, so the spacecraft is not designed to land on the surface. But a lot of valuable data can still be collected by this orbiter, just like is still happening with the active orbiters NASA is currently using on Mars.
The story noted this spacecraft has a long trip before reaching Jupiter. When does NASA expect to be able to start studying the data captured by the Europa Clipper?
Yes, that point was addressed by NASA officials in the last press briefing. The trip to Jupiter is expected to take 6 years, and mission leaders say about 1 year after that, the spacecraft will begin making closer flybys of Europa. So no data on the moon is expected before then, but NASA officials did say that even after first arriving at Jupiter, the spacecraft's imaging equipment should be able to send back high-quality pictures that should give us a better idea what this gas giant looks like up close today.
All right. Thanks again for being here, Brian, and thank you for your report.
Sure, Ashley. Thank you for having me.
You can read and listen to Brian's report on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. You can also take a quiz to test your understanding of the material. And always remember, you can write us an email with questions or comments. learningenglish@voanews.com. VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Is Anna Mateo.
And my name is Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
You're listening to the Learning English Podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In the lessons we have been watching lately, Anna has been trying new things at work. In lesson 18, she tried reading the news.
And the best word to describe that experience is challenging. Miss Weaver asked Anna to read the news without showing her feelings. Anna is very expressive, so that was difficult.
I hope her boss gives her another opportunity in this lesson. Let's watch the beginning of lesson 19, a lesson we call, When Do I Start? Anna is talking with her boss on the phone to explain why she is late coming to work.
Hi there! Summer in Washington, D.C. is hot and sunny. I always ride the metro to work. Riding the metro is cool and fast, but today it's closed. So I am walking to work.
Whew.
Ms. Weaver, I am late this morning. The metro is closed, so I am walking to work.
That's too bad. It's really hot today.
Yes, it is.
When you arrive, please come to my office. I have important news to tell you.
Of course. Goodbye. My boss has news for me. The question is it good news or bad news?
This is a phrase you will often hear in jokes and daily conversation. We talk about something being good news or bad news and give our listener a choice to hear one of them first. What do you think she will hear, Andrew?
I think she might hear some bad news, since she had so many problems trying to read the news objectively, as we said in our last podcast. Let's watch and find out.
Hello, Ms. Weaver.
Anna, I have good news and I have bad news. Which do you want to hear first?
The good news. No. Okay, the bad news.
Notice the way Ms. Weaver asked Anna to choose. She said, which do you want to hear first? If we have some difficult news or criticism to tell someone, we can add a more pleasant comment to make it easier to take.
A spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down, right? Let's see what the bad news is first.
The bad news is you are not good at reading the news.
Oh, I am very sorry to hear that.
So, starting next month, you will not read the news.
Next month is July. You are firing me in July.
No, I am not firing you in July, or in August, or in September. That is the good news.
Okay. You are not firing me. I am not reading the news. What will I be doing?
Once again, you're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins. If any of our listeners are not familiar with the word Anna uses here, firing, it means when someone is ordered to leave their job. Here we heard good news and bad news. The good news was that Anna will not lose her job. The bad news is Anna is not very good at reading the news.
I wonder what new position Anna will have. Did you notice how Anna summarized what Ms. Weaver says, or what she thinks she said? This is a skill we call summarizing. That means saying something you read or heard again, in a shorter and simpler way.
A lot of school assignments involve summarizing. In fact, you could say a big part of our job here at VOA Learning English is summarizing. We take news stories and put them into simpler sentences. And Anna summarized what she heard Ms. Weaver say as a way of confirming her understanding.
Okay. You are not firing me. I am not reading the news. What will I be doing?
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Andrew Smith. Maybe Ms. Weaver should review Anna's skills and try to find something she's more able to do.
Great idea, Andrew. I think you'll be happy with the next clip, then.
Well, you are good at asking questions. You are good at talking to people. You are good at showing your feelings. And you are great at being silly.
Thank you, Ms. Weaver. But what does all that mean?
I have a new assignment for you. Your skills are perfect for a new show. A children's show.
A children's show. That is awesome! When do I start?
You start next month. Start thinking of ideas for the show.
That sounds familiar. I think she has tons of ideas for the show, too. But you're right. Ms. Weaver helps Anna to see her strengths and gives her a new assignment. She doesn't want to spend a lot of time discussing them, so she summarizes them this way.
Well, you are good at asking questions. You are good at talking to people. You are good at showing your feelings. And you are great at being silly.
Jill, have you ever changed roles at a job?
Yeah, lots of times. But I had one job where I started out with limited responsibilities. But gradually, my supervisor saw that I had some skills in organizing projects. So I was given more responsibility.
Skills like that can be learned through experience or by working with someone who is more experienced than you are. I think you might also have some talent, which is a quality you're born with.
I've never thought about that talent in relation to career skills. How about you? What talents and skills do you think are most valuable in your job?
It's a good question, and I think that's kind of a chicken and egg question or chicken and egg idea. That means it's hard to say which one comes first. I think I've developed some of my natural talents, like being able to use my voice well, maybe being able to sing a few simple songs or something like that. And those skills can help with broadcasting. I think other skills, like writing, have come mostly from my education and working to improve them.
I think you have great people skills, too, like the soft skills we talked about in another podcast. I had to learn those skills myself because I was very shy when I was younger.
Yes, those soft skills sometimes take some time to learn, just like other skills. Now, I think before we go today, we should give our listeners a good news, bad news joke.
Are you sure? Most of those jokes are pretty dark. I mean, they deal with some serious issues like illness.
That's true, but don't worry. I have a good one. Here's the joke. There's a troop of soldiers out in the middle of the desert. The captain gets his men together and says, "I have good news and bad news. The bad news is we have run out of food and there is nothing to eat but sand."
Oh, I know this one. The captain goes on to say, "The good news is there's plenty of sand."
Oh.
So that's all for this lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. I'm Jill Robbins.
And I'm Andrew Smith. Be sure to follow us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.